analysis of our organizers, Thomas, Antonis, and Maria. Thank you for the spectacular work you're doing, and I'm very happy to be part of this. I also call it a lucky moment in this afternoon's conference because I like to relate my paper a little more closely to what we heard this morning. For instance, and this may serve as my prologue, let's say, to what I bring today, which is a case study of a lesser-known theatrical play. I was struck by Lorna Hornswick's last questions, the questions she left us with, when she asked for the most significant text and authors in transmission, the most significant text and authors in transformation, the most, again, a superlative, diverse range of elements. I see things unproblematized, and that is the key that comes to my text, unproblematized by our drive to mainstream perception studies, when I think there is so much richness to be found in the smaller texts. So as much as Cyprus Research Promotion Foundation are on our radar, let's say, I would also very much like to make an argument for the serendipities, the paradigmatic value that comes out of studying the smaller text, the forgotten text, the completely ignored text for that matter. And today I hope to bring you such a sample. So yes, I'm a little startled by as much as we still discovering this reception studies and the classical reception and modern Greek reception, I'm also a little startled by our drive to go for superlatives, canones, and mainstreaming. Another topic that came up this morning, and that again can work as some sort of a framework to my text, is our search for history, history as prophecy, history as reenactment, the use of historians as text in the broader sense of the word, because I will be discussing Herodotus, Aeschylus, and Plutarch, as if they're all historical sources, which is a bit of a stretch, but that's not what I'm going to do right now. There is certainly, in our text today, a braiding of that concept, that very productive concept of interweaving, that shows that an early 19th century pseudo-tragedy, melodrama, can actually very comfortably accommodate historical sources and references to historians mixed to ancient myth and a good doses of tragedy, and out of that interesting synergy actually present something digestible, not stimulating. So, without further ado, then, I'd like to delve in our text, and I hope you have by now all received a handout. I'd like to start by saying that the 19th century Greek engagement with Aeschylus Persians is a lot more intense, and I would also like to say a lot more indicative of a deliberate movement towards establishing the modern nation state. I've seen a lot of studies of that earliest modern Greek theatre and eagerness to embrace every text. I've more and more been making an argument that the reuse of the Persian War, not just of Aeschylus Persians, not just of the mythification of the Persian Wars, is actually not just a phenomenon of early modern Greek theatre. I would almost dare to say it's a driving force of it. And our text definitely belongs in that climate. I have explored another phenomenon of Aeschylus Persians in the 1820s that has a direct relation to the Revolutionary Wars, but today we're kind of studying a precursor to what is not a single example, but I would say a part of a wave of the early 19th century. So the historical tragedy, then, referring now to Aeschylus Persians, speaks of victory over the Eastern enemies, and the Greeks of the early 19th century see the play as a medium in which to engage again in a military but also a cultural war with the Turks, with the prestige of the ancient text, and with the recipe for victory that is somewhat embedded in the ancient text. So in the years leading up to the revolution of 1821, it is not as much as the Persians that it's all the rage, but it is the larger background of the Persian Wars that actually transforms Aeschylus Persians into some sort of a celebratory, useful text rather than a tragedy that speaks of pain and loss. Augustus of 472 BCE was a direct conduit of communication with the classical Greek past, what else then did the Greeks of the cultural wars against the Turks incorporate as they are performing the Greekness that will project them as a modern nation, as a modern state, as victorious over their enemies? I say that effective use of all sources, ancient, including Aeschylus' historical tragedy, is actually the success of it comes in the hybrid nature, the hybrid formula that they apply to an album of text and from which they distill usefulness as they see fit. It is precisely because they don't make a faithful reception of Aeschylus' versions that they can literally transform Aeschylus' versions in something that serves the 1810s and the 1820s. Of course, by that time, they also needed to infuse the text and that patrimony of the Persian Wars with other texts that will help propel them forward as they engage in their new Persian Wars. So I'm looking for answers and examples then, for specific examples in what I call a quasi tragedy, a verse adaptation of Aeschylus' versions written around 1805 and called, for lack of a title, Persians or Aeschylus, already placing itself immediately in the Aeschylean tradition. It is caught between theater, history, entertainment, instruction, and nationalist reenactment that observes theater in those days as well. I call it a quasi-tragedy, and the play, which is written by either Stephanos or Epiphanios Dimitriadis, this may be the same person, but we're not sure of his first name, so Stephanos or Epiphanios Dimitriadis. It explains why I left the first name of the title. This quasi-tragedy becomes a crucible in which tragedy, history, melodrama, and both early modernity, pre-revolutionary fervor all blend or become interwoven. It has wit to it, it has dramatic verve to it, human interest stories, in addition to references to classical tragedy and ancient history. It shows how traditional and philological material can be creatively and actually very boldly reworked to respond to truly modern audiences and very contemporary needs of the 1810s and 1820s. I noted the date of 1805, but I should actually have put a question mark to this. I would hopefully in another paper like to prove that the place probably a little later. So when I refer to the 1810s, I assess that the place belongs there better, but I don't have the tools that I have to make that case very cogently. I want to discuss with you today how this place is representative of a new performative tradition that infuses the past with the nation's desire to be not only historical, but also Western, and certainly no longer belated when it comes to fast advancing Western European countries who are expressing their philharmonic support for what will be the historical, the military, and also the cultural battle against the Turks. I will dissect the bold play into its various foreign components and show how these ingredients together still serve a modern Greek nationalist agenda, even though the melodrama, you would say, and the sapphic opera that is certainly in it, would certainly detract from that single-minded nationalist agenda. You can already tell that this is not a case of merely vertical reception. This is if there is such a thing, vertical and lateral deception is a constant interaction, a constant infusion. I see Dimitriadis' play then as a signpost on Greece's path into its revolutionary years and its immediate post-revolutionary times as well. I need to contribute then to classical perception studies with an example of this creative intermingling of various very distinct but very compatible receptive traditions, older and more recent alike, vertical and lateral, and stress the symbolic and the iconic meaning that the Persian Wars proved to play once again as we move to the late 19th century, where that phenomenon actually is registered and described. translated. Very often, that new interpretation of the Persian Wars, of Aeschylus and anything Persian War related, becomes a new dish that doesn't necessarily even hold historically true connections with the actual facts and sources. A few practical details about our play called The Persians Are the Xerxes. Stephanos of Epiphanius Dimitriades lived from 1760 to 1827, and he wrote this adaptation of Aeschylus' Persians in 15-syllable verse and in a similar vernacular register of the Greek language. His play was edited by Yorgos Valetas, who's done a few, and he Valetas named Aeschylus as a definitive source. I tend to think that he got it wrong right there and that he didn't bother to look much further. But it gave the play some sort of an instant hero, an instant prestige. He untitled it, Valetas not, Persians Are Xerxes, because Dimitriades himself had left the work without a title. Dimitriades' play draws liberally, generously, from Herodotus and Plutarch as well. And it does that actually not to fortify its historical meaning, but to fortify its melodramatic bent. It has all these subplots that read like Ottoman court intrigues, and they're very much pivoting around, necessarily, female characters and love interests. Thus, Dimitriades' play resembles something of the heroic, moralizing melodramas of the earlier French and Italian tradition, and more specifically, what we know as the opera tradition of the Castrazio. He was the beloved Western court poet with a very keen sense of theater, but also with a very keen knowledge of Plutarch. And there are other Plutarch specialists in the audience, so I mean, we'll refer to them for the specifics. Now, Nicosia-Cyprus belabored that taste that 17th and 18th century Western European opera cultivated, which is very much part of a court culture. It has a penchant for the celebratory and for morally uplifting endings. It's very wonderful if your ancient history can have a happy ending all over again. Such operas responded to the interests of the contemporary monarchs. They not only sustained monarchy, but actually recreated, and they're sustained by it. The emphasis is on foundation, pedigree, nobility of birth, character, and finale of harmony, in which simple folks are actually downplayed and ignored. Metastasio provides our author, far more than Aeschylus' Persians, with an incentive for applying a creative translation strategy, translation, appropriation, homage. It is because of this amalgamation of Aeschylean totality and dialogue, Aeschylean techniques which are still present, but then also heroic vignettes from Herodotus, edifying messages that come from Plutarch, and then those emotional romantic scenes that come from Nicosia-Cyprus, that we get this strange project that is our pseudo-tragedy. I call this an eclectic translation strategy with emphasis on each of the words, but perhaps most on strategy, because there is a military hook here that is that makes the play a tool of going into battle culturally and militarily against the Turks. Valetas actually told us quite boldly that contemporary Italian and French theater plays did not affect this piece, and he did not enter into details. If he had scratched the move further, he would have thought otherwise. But I think he's still very much part of that tendency, that Israeli tendency, that is a little bit obsessed by the fact that as soon as we acknowledge Western influences, it would detract from the resonance of Aeschylus' powerful original. I don't subscribe to that. So Eumenides was a teacher from Skiathos in Sporades, who gained access to the Greek aristocracy in Constantinople and who worked as secretary tutor to the Phanariots in Bucharest and to also some high-placed clerics in the Orthodox Church. He mastered various registers of the Greek language in addition to some pretty good French. It's actually in French that he makes a dedication of some of his works to Alexandros Moulouzis, who you know from the Ottoman superstructure over some of the principalities. And this Moulouzis, interestingly enough, had two sons who who are key players in the 1820 presentation of Aeschylus' Persians, that is an immediate kinetron to the Greek Revolution, about which I've written on another occasion. Later in life, Archimedes actually took part in the Greek War of Independence, not unusual, a popular theatre call to arms and an actual mobilization in the war is not an exceptional phenomenon. And then, of course, inevitably, we must entertain the idea that he may have crossed paths with Rigas Philistinis or Rigas Philaeus, a precursor of the revolutionary struggle, who is also a great advocate, not just of theatre, but of revolutionary theatre. There is some rumor that a play may have been staged in Constantinople in 1818, but we don't have much of evidence to support it. But it seems to at least suggest that our idea that the play could be later, not 1805, but 1810s, even the late 1810s, could hold some validity to it. I'm occasionally struck, and here I extend a bit for support. I'm occasionally struck by the very modern quality of Dimitriadis' speech, an almost a satirical quality. And there's one particular passage in which I am actually not entirely sure what to think of it, because it should be far more serious, and because of the drama, it almost sounds comical. So please keep an eye out, because you need to help me with that. Dimitriadis wrote a total of three plays, and they all attest to an interest in ancient Greek myth and history. There's the comedy of Epimetheus and Pandora, there's the dialogue of Olympias and Diogenes, and there is On Xerxes. Theater historian Yannis Sideris, who has the credit of being the only one back in the days, but who also has the credit of putting out a lot of mistakes, said that our authors completely out of touch with the theatrical realities of Europe at the time. Another blatant ignoring of the influence of Metastasio, which is very prominent in this play. I would say that not only is our play very much in terms of the Latin opera tradition that is making the waves in Western Europe, I would even say that it's also infused with a very Orientalist prejudice that was part of that tradition. The Orientalist notes in this 1805 play underscore that spirit of Greek self-congratulation and victory celebration and confirms the continuous message that the Ottoman Empire is indeed the sick man of Europe, that it is on the decline, and that this is down to strength. Now, to give Aeschylus credit where Aeschylean credit is due, as I already said, the Aeschylean elements in this play are elements of technique more than of content. The presentation of the play is still from the perspective of the Persians, which was quite revolutionary back in Aeschylus' day. There is the appearance of Galaris' most striking scenic element in monologue with Xerxes. There is the humiliation of Xerxes, you remember him in rags at the end of the tragedy. There is the unexpectedness of the Greek victory over the Eastern enemy, even though we already know that, but it's reenacted as unexpected, and I'm very much. And there is that constant technique of delivering praise of the Greeks, but in a third-person voice. And if you put that third-person voice in an enemy body, then the indirect praise becomes all the more potent. That's the technique that Aeschylus applies when he gives Queen Atossa some resonating lines in the ancient play, and sure enough, our author does the same. But then, and here's where the other influence comes in, the greater appeal came from Metastasio. As early as 1779, six translations of the libretti of Metastasio were in circulation. As a translator, the name of Yorgos Soutsos circulates, and of course, because these were available in Greek, I then immediately looked for which of those operas actually have Persian war content. And sure enough, we have an opera Artaxerxes from 1730 and Cyrus from 1726, which are all about Persian kings and courts and therefore chronological sources of inspiration. But as much as Dimitriadis sticks, he also made integrate and pronounce. If metastasia is quite known for pretty complicated amorous plots interwoven with historical plots, and the material is actually obviously active. Arpey appears in Arpey no less than 25 characters appear, which would be, of course, an Pascalian nightmare. There's Xerxes, his foes, mistresses, Leonidas, traitors, Themistocles, Aristides, and even Persia personified. And then, of course, a few larger groups need to be accommodated. They too are part of the operative tradition. And you will see that the ancient chorus of elders is now dialogic performance of counselors who try to put toxic sense into Xerxes without much result. So you see an overdoing of characters that also becomes a hyper, becomes the network of a hyper intensity when complications and romantic intrigues are involved. Metastasios at Xerxes was hugely popular, and it saw widespread, including translations, musical settings across the Western world. With this work, Xerxes shares the infatuation with a mistress. But Xerxes, Metastasio, as his hero, basically supersedes his private desire, his romantic desire. And our hero, Eumenides, actually becomes ruled by passion. And it was precisely in these kind of shifts that you could see that Eumenides calls for the erotic, the passionate, the bold, oriental strokes that have to go to the detriment of the Eastern enemy even further. The Xerxes of Eumenides may be an all-powerful monarch, but he's enslaved by emotions and shows a little nobility in his thinking and conduct. He is therefore an antipode of the free Greek citizens who defend their invaded fatherland and become historical prototypes all over again. Nobility is the prerogative of the Greeks and the Greeks only, whom the Persians are constantly trying to enslave, including in their modern incarnation as Turks. A second source is, of course, our Plutarch, the formative influence of Plutarch, about which a lot more needs to be said, is that I think that Plutarch as a source for early modernity has been vastly underestimated. Plutarch was a rich source for pre-revolutionary theater overall, including the Western countries in France and England, and especially for Metastasio, and then we get a good dose of Plutarch through Metastasio in our own play. Metastasio's Themistocles, very much drawing on Plutarch's line of Themistocles, saw no less than four early translations into modern Greek, and these early translations and plays are also very much the vehicles of the phenomenon of patriotic nationalist theatre in Odessa, 1814, leading up to the Revolutionary War. Mind you, the Greeks of the day, in the 1810s, have no problem at all going into a revived classics, revived Persian wars with Western prototypes, instead of returning to Aeschylus' Persians as a play in and of itself, they would much rather return to the Metastasian interpretation of the life of Themistocles that such sheds for them enough light on Persian war-related events. This is an anomaly or a surprise to us, but it's not a single case. There are other occasions of it. Cutting down a little bit, so I'll go through various marks, signposts in the five acts of the play, and you can follow with me on your handout. Another theory of tragedy positions itself as a historical drama, but more prominent than the defeat of a king Persius is its moral decline. The defeat is not necessarily a moral one, it is very clearly an ethical one, a moral one, and therefore that kind of moral decline of the Easterners should add additional incentive to the Greeks. Xerxes becomes the big peg on which the playwright has hung exotic plot twists, favorite romantic tales, east-west stand-ups, and so much more. The first scene is set in Xerxes' royal palace, and the king is still still haunted by Varese's call to take revenge on the Greeks for his own defeat at Marathon in 490 BCE. And Xerxes then is urged by his father in second person singular, and again in that rather colloquial language, Xerxes. Here he's not asking the thesis to the Amazonas, Elinas, cannot use Amphalesis. Xerxes then seeks the advice of his counselor, and they exactly tell him what he likes to hear, with visions of a prostrated Greece, a Greece that will be easy to conquer. And of course, he's also the gullible monarch who eats it up. The person who speaks against that is not given much of a serious hearing. And so Xerxes starts preparing his huge military campaign, and again the emphasis is on the brazenness of certain events. His plan to cut through the Mount Athos Peninsula, reference to Herodotus, and also his building of the pontoon bridge over the Hellespont. And then all of a sudden, as we all hear that for war and invasion of Greece, Dimitriades turns to romance. Xerxes meets his mistress, who's actually the wife of his brother, who has no clue. This is again Herodotus at work. And then the king tells his mistress about the upcoming campaign, and it's worried about the physical, the geographical distance that will put the war will put in between them. This exchange, unexpected as it is, serves again to unmask Xerxes as the psychologically weaker party, weaker than his mistress in this case. There is also, of course, the sexual transgression going on. Our Xerxes is repulsive for abandoning his mistress, for the cruel designs of his jealous wife that he lets once she learns about her husband's infidelities. Now the plot of this romance, this unexpected romance, is actually even thicker in Herodotus, but it certainly comes as an unexpected intermezzo in our play. But it does serve the purpose of revealing a Xerxes who is readily flattered, easily influenced, cowardly, selfish, and unjust to the core. Again, the moment of time of not just Xerxes, but the entire Persian court. Now, it was not entirely alien to go for very graphic means of punishment as with Xerxes and his mistress and his wife, and Metastasio too had already given us a means that if you want to stay theatrical viable, you have to up the ante and to return to more and more graphic means, even in blood-related thirstiness. Act 2 then, Xerxes is already at Thermopylae after having crossed the Hellespont, and of course, northern Greece falls in quick succession. And then we get in those typical episodes that come from Herodotus, Xerxes observing that the Spartans actually do their hair before they go into battle, and again, that third person praise of the Greeks, who are willing to die to the last man in an ethos of self-sacrifice for Greece, and specifically that last element of self-sacrifice for the greater cause that has to ring true. By now, we're again on the nationalist patriotic track. Now, the Maratos finds an opportunity to warn the vain Xerxes that victory over Greeks is not as easy as it sounds, with the ringing words, Yadiniatinemi, Nilipetachtis, as I say, Kimetinemi, that Trichitus in the Praxis only to the Romans. By giving so much emphasis to the Herodotian story, especially book 7 and 8 of Herodotus, our Dimitriades is actually following the line charted by Adamantius Coralis, who told the newly developing nation of Greece that Herodotus should definitely be on the reading list of the young Greeks' education, with much more emphasis on Herodotus than Aeschylus' versions. In Act 3, Xerxes is a psalmist, and just as he's admiring and pondering what a wondrous sight he must make for his troops to behold, he also realizes that he's losing the battle. And then he flees through the Hellespont, which he now has to cross in a humble fishing boat to find safety in Asia. In Act 4, the episode with Mardonius, who's left behind in Greek territory, gives us an opportunity to, again, for the Dimitriades again to resort to Herodotus and to let the Greeks speak to their community of blood, language, gods, temples, rituals, and to their pure sense of unity against a common enemy. And it is in this passage where I'm a little startled by the liveliness of a tone in such a serious context that is created by the rather contrived rhyming of Dimitriades. If you see Apollyon, Apollyon, Stygian, Xenopollyon, Mirror of Stygian, Andravapia, Kegian, Andravapia, I am not sure how that can stand as a serious text. To me, it almost has something of the late 19th century satire. Open question to you. Act 5 is an act that we actually didn't need anymore. After all, Mardonius is dying, Xerxes is long gone. Act 5 is there to basically love being the message. History as a prophecy, if the Greeks can defeat the Persians back then, they can do it all over again. It is, after all, manifest history. So there is more language here to reiterate that the Greeks should be made with full boldness to go and call out throwing off the Turkish yoke. And I let you read the lines that go with that. And of course, this is an opportunity to put the Persian Wars, the Turkish Wars, and the Trojan Wars in one long historical sweep, because centuries mean very little in this focus. In conclusion, then, Dimitriades, Persians, or Xerxes draws on a wide range of soldiers to strengthen modern Greek revolutionary resolve. And it does so with confidence and without yielding to the pressure to stick to pure classicizing. Aeschylus' Persians provided the models of play, direct inquiry, and indirect praise. But Herodotus furnished the sought-after vignettes of Greek heroism, integrity, and even mass self-sacrifice. Herodotus, too, was part and parcel of the New Nation's forward-looking didactic program. Along with other members of the pre-revolutionary Greek intelligentsia, our Dimitriades makes the exponents of ancient Greek glory and also the Greek historical sources, historians and sources, undergo a new process of reappraisal. From Aeschylus to Herodotus and Plutarch, they're all measured, now remeasured, on the scale of their perceived modern patriotism, and their works are mined for their 19th century nationalist merit. Dimitriades portrayed of Xerxes not as a three-dimensional character, but as a bloodthirsty Eastern despot. So the melodramatic scenes then that are there from Metastasio confound that realm of classical literature, add spice and color to the interpretation, and hopefully make it a more palatable product as the battle to mobilize the Greeks go on. And I respect your voting.